how to make asking for help immediately easier. Hey, my dear, I am leadership development coach Kathy Archer and author of best-selling book, Mastering Confidence. Today, we are going to talk about how to make asking for help easier. What I know to be true is many women hit this point in their career where, you know, in leadership, you start to feel in over your head and you wonder if you have what it takes to lead. In my courses, in my coaching, in my Facebook Lives, in my book, I teach you the inner and outer tools to restore your lost confidence so that you, my dear, can move from surviving to thriving in both leadership and life. But in order to do that, you need to ask for a little bit of help sometimes. So we're going to get into today how to make asking for help just a wee bit easier. While we are doing this, I'm going to share this into my Confident Women Leaders group. I have to find it on my phone here. The Confident Women Leaders group is a group of other women leaders also learning and growing themselves, and they're learning in community. So we're having some conversations, we're supporting each other. If you want to be a part of a community of other women leaders, make sure you click the link up in the notes here and ask to join. And while I'm doing this, what I want to know is write a post, share to group, Confident Women Leaders group, post it. Today's session is brought to you by the Leadership Circle Profile. The Leadership Circle Profile is a 360-degree assessment for women or men leaders, but I just work with you got nice ladies mostly, but for leaders who want to grow and develop themselves and to be all they can be and are looking for some honest, reliable, maybe non-judgmental feedback to be that best leader, and maybe you're struggling to get that. The 360 Leadership Circle Profile gets that feedback from your peers, your boss, your people, maybe the subordinates that you supervise, your direct reports, but also your colleagues, perhaps, or stakeholders in the community, and they pull at the circle pulls it all together, and then it comes back to you and I as a coach. And here's where the Leadership Circle is unique. You also get coaching attached to this. So you take the results of the Leadership Circle, you and I work together to sift through that feedback, make some meaningful goals, and then develop yourself. If you are interested in learning more about the Leadership Circle Profile, go to silverrivercoaching.com, TLC, the Leadership Circle, yes, TLC, silverrivercoaching.com, TLC. And you'll find more information about it. And stay tuned. If you are on my email list, expect an email on Sunday that gives you some crazy cool information about the Leadership Circle that you just might be interested in. So back to today's show. I think we're good. Confident Women Leaders Group, the Leadership Circle. Oh, so what I want to know, comment, when was the last time you had an evaluation, a performance appraisal, a 360? Was it, you know, in the last 6 months? Was it in the last year? Maybe you can't remember, or maybe you've never had one. So comment in the notes. And if you're really brave, make an additional comment that says it was really helpful or it was not so helpful. Because that's what I often see for women is that it's either been a really long time or you've had them, but they're just not helpful. And so I want to offer you this as a tool to get some different advice, feedback, and make sure that you can really apply it. Okay, I'm rambling. Let's get back on focus here. Last week, we talked about three fears that hold you back from being your best self. And again, I want to come back to this because I think this is the thing where most of women leaders feel a sense of inner turmoil. They know that they're not being their best. They know there's more in them, more potential, better ability to make an impact. They know that there's a desire to have more of a work-life balance, and they know that if they had more of that work-life balance, that they probably would show up in leadership better. They know that they have the ability to grow and develop their staff more, but man, they never find the time or never get the focus, or there's just so many other fires to put out that often that stuff that would make you feel like you were that incredible leader gets pushed to the side. Now, I know that you can change that, and so do a zillion other people, and probably you do too. But there are three fears that get in the way of that. And we talked about those on last week's session. And those three fears are, first, the fear of failure. I'm afraid that if I try and learn something new, change things up, take some training, set some goals, do something different, I'm afraid that I'm going to fail. I'm going to look like an idiot. People are going to judge me. I'm going to make a bigger mess of things. So fear of failure is the first one. The second one that many, many women struggle with is the fear that their family's going to get in the way, or that it's going to be perceived as others as a weakness or something that's going to get in the way. So maybe you aren't going to talk about your family because, you know, there's a promotion coming up and you don't want your boss or your organization to think that you're too family oriented, or you're afraid to take time off to go to your kids' school because they got an award, because, you know, that seems like you're putting family more important than work. So that's a fear that many of us have. And then the third fear that so many women leaders have is this fear of not measuring up, this fear of the sort of imposter syndrome, or that we will never be as good as other people. And it's those three fears, that fear of failure, fear that your family's going to get in the way, or fear that you're not going to measure up, that holds us back. And so we know there's more in us. We have this incredible capacity to be a better leader, show up differently, actually make a bigger impact, but we're a little bit afraid. And so what we talked about last week was three things that you can do to sort of get through those fears. The first one is create that powerful vision. You've heard me talk about this a zillion times. And, you know, it's kind of like creating that vision board on steroids. There's a guide sheet. If you go to silverrivercoaching.com/guides, you'll find one of the guide sheets is the lesson on creating a powerful vision. But it's more than just a vision board. It's about really creating the feelings and the experience. And what does that vision look like? What is it like on a day-to-day basis when you are that more impactful leader, when you feel better about the way that you're leading? What happens in your conversations? What kind of work are you getting done? What are the feelings that you have? What's on your to-do list versus what's on your to-do list today? And so you create that powerful vision. That's step one of getting over those fears. Step two then is creating the steps to get there. And this is one of the things that we do, is we create a goal. I'm going to, you know, take this training. I'm going to be more engaged with my staff. I am going to not check email first thing in the morning. And we set these wonderful goals. There's nothing wrong half the time with the goals. But what we miss then is breaking that down into smaller chunks. Okay, so if you're going to not check email first thing in the morning, what does that look like on Monday morning when there was a crisis on the weekend? How do you sort of decide what's the time frame? Maybe on Mondays you actually do check email first thing in the morning, or you have 15 minutes where you get sort of centered and do some work and then you check email. Maybe it's different every day. But then this third step is, what are you going to do when the hump, bumps, and roadblocks hit? So again, you come back to Monday morning, there was a crisis on the weekend, and there's reports to do, and all of this stuff to fill out. Then what are you going to do then? Are you still going to be able to stick to that goal? Or maybe you have the goal of spending more time with your staff and doing more one-to-one supervisions with them, and all of a sudden there's this big project that jumped in, and there's this pressure from above to get it done. How are you going to deal with that? When what happens is we start to have this inner critic say, you need to do it this way. This is what has to be done. Don't let them see that you can't handle it. It's that inner stuff that gets in the way, right? And so this leads us to today's topic. Why is it that asking for help is so hard? What gets in the way of us asking for help? You know that you want to be the best leader you can be. You've got this powerful vision. You know there's some fears there, and you've kind of started going, okay, if I want to get through this and change how I'm showing up, be more impactful, feel better about the work I do, I'm going to have to ask for help. What does asking for help make you feel? Put a note in the comment box if you're following along, either now or in the replay. When you ask for help, what do you immediately feel? For most of us, it's shame, embarrassment. We tell ourselves that we're weak if we're asking for help. We judge ourselves for not being good enough. We think that if we ask for help, we are bothering other people, that we're losing control, right? That's one of the big ones. If I ask for help, I love this, you know, when we think about how many times have you thought about asking for help, but you're like, well, they'll just do it wrong anyhow, or, you know, I'll have to redo it after. And so we know that asking for help feels like it's going to be more work. Or that if we ask for help, that we will have to reciprocate it. Meaning, if I ask for help, then they're going to turn around and ask me for help, and I'm not going to have time to help them, or I don't want to help them, or that's just going to create more work. So all of those things get in the way of us asking for help. The challenges, and I'm trying to figure out how to word this the best way, because I think we, again, see asking for help as a weakness. And I want you to really think of asking for help in a different way. And I go back to, you know, if you want to overcome those fears so you can be the best leader, you can be having the best impact, feeling the best, you need to create a plan. You need to set some goals, and you need to know how to work those goals. Asking for help is often seen as weakness because we sort of, in our own minds, judge ourselves and fear that other people are going to judge us as not being able to do those steps, not being able to work the plan. Oh, great, you have this wonderful plan, but you can't do it by yourself. It's not exactly like that. Asking for help is about looking at what is it that I need to do? What are the resources? What are the supports? What are the things that are going to help me get there? And so instead of weakness, there's three shifts that I want you to make. Instead of seeing asking for help as a weakness, I want you to shift your perspective, and I want you to see it as a strength. It's actually a strength, and I know this is so incredibly hard for some of us, but to have the courage to put yourself out there, to be vulnerable, to ask for help is actually a sign of strength. If you've ever seen someone give a speech or in a situation where they are really struggling, I'm trying to think of something, maybe somebody who's really sick and says, can you help me go to the bathroom? Can you give me that drink of water? Can you make this call for me? We look at other people and we're like, wow, that took an incredible amount of courage to ask for that kind of help. And we actually see them as strong. But when we do it ourselves, we see it as weakness. So I want you to shift that. Asking for help is actually a strength. And so if you're developing yourself as a leader to be all you can be, to have the impact you want to have, asking for help is creating that stronger leader. And that's demonstrating to the world that you want to do that, that I want to show up for you in the best way I possibly can, that I'm the best leader for you and helping you be the best person. That's a strength. So the second perspective shift that I want you to have is that it actually grows you. So if you're asking for help, first, again, it puts you in that place of vulnerability, which is an incredible place to be. It's a place we avoid and don't want to be. But the more vulnerable you put yourself, what it says is you're stepping outside your comfort zone. It means that you're becoming more aware of what's happening for me. And if I want to get over there, I'm going to have to do this. If you're standing on the edge of a sort of cliff and there's one of those swing kind of walkways, I can't remember the word for them, you're going to have to kind of step out there with your stomach churning and, you know, maybe feeling like you're ready to throw up and get to the other side. Or you're going to stay there, and you can just see that. If you're, there's a group of you, I know some of you say I won't judge people, but the truth is we do. If there's a group of you and you're standing on one side of this cliff and there's this bridge across, and, you know, four out of five of you go across, what are you thinking about the one person that didn't? You're thinking they gave up, they didn't try hard enough, they're a wimp, they're scared. And so it's getting through that fear that makes you feel that strength and grows you. Once you've crossed it once, it's not, maybe you won't do it again, but you'll have a new level of confidence. You'll be more comfortable doing new things. And that's what we need to look at, is asking for help grows us. Going through that level of vulnerability grows us. The third shift is really important, and I kept it to last because we often think that asking for help is about us. It's not. It's about somebody else. I really want you to think about what your job is as a leader. We spend so much time inward focused, so much time looking at ourselves, and I want you to turn around and look at the people that are following you. Look at the people that report to you. Look at the people that look up to you and wait for you to give them a sense of direction. They need you to be strong. They need you to be decisive. They need you to be clear. They need you to have vision. They need you to be able to set boundaries. They need you to set goals. They need you to build them up, teach them, show them, train them. They need you to be the best version of yourself. And so when you're thinking about reaching out and asking for help to grow yourself and be the best leader you can be, it's not about you. It's not about you being selfish. It's not about you putting yourself first and avoiding other people or taking time away or energy or resources from other people. It's about you being there for other people. It's about you growing and developing yourself because those people need you to show up. They need you to develop yourself. They need you to grow and be stronger. They need you to turn around and with confidence say, this is where we're going. This is how we're going to get there. And this is why we're doing it. And this is how we're going to do it. They need you. Asking for help is not about you. It's about you turning around and being there, not just at work, but for the people in your life as well. I had one client the other day that said to me, she hired a house cleaner. Okay, that's not about you being weak and not capable of doing all of the things that you're supposed to do as a woman. That's about you saying, my family needs some laundry and a clean floor and, you know, maybe some groceries bought, whatever your housekeeper does. And that's saying, I'm here for my family because I don't want to come home at the end of the day and be cleaning my house. I want to come home at the end of the day and spend time with my family. So when you ask for help, shift that and say, yeah, it's about giving back to the people I serve. So three perspective shifts. Asking for help is a strength, not a weakness. It grows and develops you. And remember, it's not about you. So those are the three things I want you to remember. Now, today's guide sheet is the Wheel of Life. And so there's a link. I'm just going to have a drink just a sec. There's a link up in the notes for you to get today's guide sheet. And it's the Wheel of Life. And so if you've ever thought about coaching with me, this is probably one of the very first things I would do with you. And we would probably do it periodically as well. The Wheel of Life takes a snapshot of today and helps you kind of look at six, eight different areas. Your family and friends, your significant other, your fun and recreation, health, money, personal growth and development, physical environment, and career. So not just career. All of those eight areas, click the link up in the notes. It is the Wheel of Life guide sheet. But you're going to do a really quick assessment. And on this assessment, you're going to kind of identify some of those places in your life that maybe you aren't at the potential you want to be. And maybe what you can do about that. And that may require you to ask for some help. But it's going to give you kind of that real quick visual of here's the best place for you to start asking for help. So I want you to grab that guide sheet. And then I want you to start thinking about help in a new way. Again, make sure you do those three shifts. Asking for help is not a weakness, it's a strength. Asking for help is, I forgot the second one, grows you. And then the third one is it's not about you, it's about the people that are looking up to you. And so take out the word help out of your vocabulary if that's awkward, weird for you. Try delegate, right? Oh, okay, so I'm going to delegate. And again, this isn't about you. It's not about you being weak and you needing help to delegate. It's about when I delegate, I'm growing the skills in other people. I'm sharing the vision for the organization. I'm allowing teamwork to develop. See the shift? Delegating is not about you being weak and incapable of doing your duties. Delegating is about getting the people you serve, getting the people that look up to you and report to you to be a part of it, to step up to the plate as well, to use their full potential. Asking for help Instead, think of it perhaps as requesting feedback. So I am competing in Toastmasters again this coming weekend in the division finals in Edmonton. So this is like the top three quarters of Alberta and Saskatchewan will all come together, and I'm competing in that competition. Now, I can sit here and go, I think I got it. I'm scared, but I think I know what I'm doing, and just stay focused, head down. But instead, what I've done is I've asked my peers in Toastmasters to give me feedback, and very specific feedback. So I've given the speech several times in our club. And one time I was asking for feedback on, you know, the structure of the speech. Another time I'm asking for feedback on my gestures. How are they? Am I using the full stage? Am I pacing? Another time I was asking for feedback on the pace of it, you know, putting pauses between sentences. So each time I'm coming back to my peers and saying, tell me, give me the feedback, show me how to develop and grow myself. And here's the interesting thing. Again, it's not about me. First, the message I'm sharing in the speech is inspirational to them. It's also inspirational to the people that I'm going to present it to this weekend. It also helps me be a better speaker for you. That's the whole goal of this, is so that I can come back here and be a better speaker for you. And then the other thing is, it grows our club. When I step up to the plate and demonstrate to the rest of the club members that we can compete with the rest of the province, the rest of the country, we have the ability to learn and grow, and you have something to teach me. Even though I'm the one going forward, I'm looking for your feedback, your advice, your input, because you are smart and intelligent. I'm growing their evaluation skills, which in some ways is a better skill, or not a better skill, but in some ways is a skill that's as powerful as speaking, if not more. If you can give honest evaluation and feedback to people that you are training and growing, that's so helpful. I mean, this good job pat on the back doesn't do anything for anybody. In fact, it just drops people's level. To be able to give that level of feedback is incredible. So I digress. So delegate, ask for feedback. One of the other ways that you can shift that frame set, mindset around asking for help is think of it as setting a boundary. So perhaps what you need to do is have more focus, and the help you're asking for is people to stay out of your way. And so as you're setting that boundary, maybe you're saying to your admin support, I'm going to shut my door. Please don't let anybody in for the next hour. And so you're creating those deep work time blocks where you can avoid the distractions and get stuff done. That's asking for help if you want to see it that way. It's also setting a boundary. You can see it as getting the important work done, right? Prioritizing might be the way you reframe asking for help. Training is another way of asking for help. So if you are struggling with a certain skill, if you are wanting to be better at something, to build on some of your strengths, you might sign up for a course. You might read a book. You might go to a conference. That's asking for help, right? If you're developing and growing yourself, help is getting new information, being trained, being skilled. Another way to ask for help, if you want to see it this way, is to reach out to an expert. Maybe it's time for you to get some counseling or some therapy because your marriage is falling apart. Maybe you need to talk to an expert about mediation in your organization or conflict resolution. Maybe you need to talk to an expert because you've been avoiding a health issue, or you need to go talk to the nutritionist. Asking to meet with an expert is asking for help. But again, come back to those three things. It's not about weakness. Going to see a nutritionist is about strength. I have the strength to say, I want to be as healthy as I can. Going and speaking to asking to meet with an expert or going to some training isn't about you. It's about growing you so that you can be the best you can be for the people that serve you. So those are some of the things I want you to think about. If you are really serious about growing and developing yourself, you are going to face some fears. That's the truth. Use that inner guidance system, thoughts, feelings, body sensations, to work through those fears that you have. create that powerful vision, lay out the steps that you need to do. Look at what are the inner and outer obstacles, what's kind of that mind chatter, that fear that's going to pop up. And then where do I need to ask for help to get through that? Because help is not weakness, help is strength. When I ask for help, it's growing myself so that I can be the best leader I can be for those people around me. It's not about me, it's about those I serve. That's what you need to work on so that you can really create and feel better about who you are. If you want some specific help with that, make sure you head over to silverrivercoaching.com, TLC. Link is in the notes, the Leadership Circle profile. Check your email on Sunday because you're going to get this email about the Leadership Circle profile that you're not going to want to miss. And head on over and grab the guide sheet today so that you can start to look at all of those facets of your life and maybe where you want to start reaching out and asking for help to be the best you can be. Because we know this, my dear, when you grow yourself to be the best you can be, what happens? You move from surviving to thriving in both your leadership and your life. Go make the rest of your day awesome.